Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lowcountry Boomerang by Susan M. Boyer, narrated by Loretta Rawlins. 1. The dead are serene, joyful characters. That's been my experience anyway. Since my best friend, Colleen, came back into my life 13 years after her funeral, mind you, the import of this has gradually permeated my brain, giving me a deep-seated sense of peace I hadn't known before. I'm truly grateful for this gift. That's not to say there aren't still days when Colleen works my very last nerve and I want to throttle her, like the day last September when I was trying to have a civilized conversation with Moon Unit Glendon at the Cracked Pot over a Cobb salad. It was the Tuesday after Labor Day. The lunch rush had slowed enough at our island diner that the waitstaff could manage things. Moon Unit, who owned the place, took a seat across from me in the pink gingham-backed booth, something she typically did when she wanted to milk me for gossip or share some. This was no ordinary day. Moon had called me the night before and said she needed to talk, which was somewhat akin to her telling me she needed to breathe. She was universally acknowledged as our town's chief information officer. Colleen popped in beside Moon. My guardian spirit wore a green gingham sundress. Her long red curls shimmered with golden highlights. The thick mane draped loose well past her shoulders. Heat and humidity had no effect whatsoever on her since her death. I'd pulled my own hair into a ponytail to get it off my neck. Colleen flashed me an impish grin and propped her elbows on the table. She was up to something, no doubt about it. I glanced at the ceiling, took a deep, cleansing breath. Liz, is this not a good time? Moon clutched her chest with both hands. Of course, it's fine. I grabbed something from thin air. I was just thinking about Daddy. Moon twirled a finger through her own ponytail, it a more golden shade of blonde than my multi-toned version. She flashed me a knowing look. Your poor mama is a saint walking this earth, and that's all there is to it. Nothing harder to deal with than a sick man. Every little sniffle, they think they're about to die. Well, his little sniffle has now turned to bronchitis. Bronchitis? Moon gave me an incredulous look. He sneezed twice at the pool party week before last. You know, Daddy, he was running a fever that next night, wouldn't go to the doctor, refused to take care of himself. He had a miserable cold within a couple days. By the time Mama got him over to Warren Harper, it was bronchitis. I am so sorry to hear that, said Moon. Is there anything I can do? I know. I'll whip up a pot of chicken soup and run it by. That's sweet of you, really. But Mama's got a 16-quart stock pot full of soup on the stove. She's trying to feed it to all of us to ward off the germs. I told her it's too hot to be eating soup. She's going to end up freezing some of it as it is. Doc Harper wrote Daddy 4 prescriptions, gave him strict orders to rest in bed, and sent him home with Mama. I hope you know I didn't mean to sound unsympathetic to your daddy's suffering. Bronchitis can be serious business. Even a cold is a misery in this blistering hot weather. It's just, your poor Mama. I know. Everyone on this island knew my daddy was a piece of work. He's turned the corner, we think, but you're right, he's not an easy patient, to say the least. Anyway, how's your family? Everyone doing okay? Moon waved a hand dismissively. They're fine. Sonny? I hadn't talked to Sonny Ravenel since we wrapped up the Drayton case about a week ago. Sonny was a Charleston police detective. My husband, Nate Andrews, and I were private investigators. Our paths crossed professionally on occasion. Sonny was also my brother Blake's best friend. I'd known Sonny forever. Colleen leaned in. Moon glanced over her shoulder like maybe she was verifying no one had sat down behind her. Her eyes slid around the room. She leaned in. Sonny? She said casually. Oh, he's fine. I scrunched my face at her. Something was off. Y'all still dating? I asked. 4 months now. Happiness shone from her eyes. Sonny and Moon, said Colleen like she was about to follow it up with sitting in a tree. This might stick after all. That's like totally awesome. Of course, no one but me could hear her. She was in ghost mode, her default setting. Colleen, like me, was a teenager in the 90s. But while I grew out of that, Colleen would forever be 17, the age she was when she drank tequila and went swimming in Breach Inlet, which everyone in town knew was suicide, but no one mentioned in polite conversation. I was thinking how 4 months was a record for both Sunny and Moon. I smiled back at her. Y'all sure seem to make each other happy. She kept smiling, tucked a non-existent stray lock of hair behind her ear. Then she glanced around again. "Spit it out already," said Colleen. I waited for Moon to speak her piece. She called this meeting. "It's just..." She licked her lips, took a breath. Her shoulders rose and fell. Moon tilted her head. "You know how when you really know someone, you can read between the lines?" "Sure," I said. "I'm almost positive Sonny intended for me to tell you this, but he'd never, ever admit that. I've got to figure out a way to tell you without telling you."
"Tell me what exactly?"
"Well, you know about Trina Lynn Causby, of course." Moon shook her head. "Just heartbreaking."
"Did Sonny catch that case?" Trina Lynn Causby was Troy Cosby's oldest sister. My sister Mary had an unfortunate lapse in judgment and dated Troy Cosby for a while, but that was a whole nother story.
Moon nodded. "Mm-hmm. Him and his new partner."
"Sonny has a new partner?" I caught myself furrowing my brow and responded instantly to Mama's voice in my head admonishing me about wrinkles. I smoothed the skin between my eyebrows.
"Didn't I mention that?"
Colleen's eyes glinted mischievously.
"Detective Jenkins," said Moon.
I pondered that. I'd met Detective Jeremy Jenkins a time or two. He was a decent enough guy. Seemed like a good detective. He probably wasn't my biggest fan, but still, reassignments aren't all that uncommon.
"That's what Sonny said," said Moon. "But Detective Jenkins, Jeremy, he's one of those that's a stickler for policies, protocol, procedures, all such as that."
"This'll be trouble," said Colleen.
"Hey, don't forget my ham biscuits. You didn't order them when you ordered your salad."
One of the benefits of being departed was that Colleen never had to count calories. She did have to materialize to eat, something she couldn't do in public. I ordered enough takeout with my meals to make folks wonder if maybe I suffered from an eating disorder. I said, "So there's something about the Trina Lynn Causby case Sonny wants me to know, but he and I can't have coffee and discuss it. Why doesn't he just call me?" Moon studied something over my shoulder.
"I'm not 100% certain, but I think he doesn't want to have to lie to his partner, and he knows Jenkins wouldn't cotton to discussing an active case with the P.I.
"Maybe, especially this P.I.?"
"Maybe so,"
Moon winced.
"Or a local small-town police chief."
Sonny couldn't get Blake to tell me, so Moon unit was up. My brother was the Stella Maris chief of police. Something seriously unusual was going on here. Sonny had a burner phone specifically to talk to Blake when he technically couldn't. Trina Lynn was shot in Philadelphia Alley Sunday night. The news made it sound like a robbery gone bad. Do they already have a suspect?
"So, not what happened," said Colleen.
"What do you know about this?"
I threw the thought at her. Usually, she could read my mind, which was how I communicated with her when other folks were around, so they didn't have me carted off to the nervous hospital.
"I know it was cold-blooded murder, but that's all the information I've been given at this point," said Colleen. "The fact that I know that much means there's a connection to this island."
Colleen's afterlife mission was serving as the guardian spirit of Stella Maris, our island home just north of Isle of Palm, South Carolina.
"I think they might have a suspect in mind. More iced tea?"
Moon picked up the pitcher and filled my glass.
By the way, have you seen Darius Baker since he moved back home?
Darius Baker? The question seemed completely random. I drew a blank. Colleen burst out in her signature bray snort guffaw.
When you draw your chin back like that and squint your face up, you remind me of your Uncle Cecil. Hush up.
Mama's youngest brother Cecil took a greyhound to Florida a few years back. The last we heard, he'd started his own church somewhere near Orlando. He sent Mom a postcard once with a picture of him, shaved bald, cloaked in a white robe, standing in front of a statue of Mary that wept blood. He had an albino boa constrictor draped across his shoulders as big around as a cat. I guess no one told Cecil that the snakes handled in religious services were generally the poisonous kind. We didn't discuss Uncle Cecil. It upset Mama. Moon examined her manicure.
What does Darius Baker have to do with Trina Lynn being robbed and murdered? I asked.
Moon shrugged, looked innocent.
No, I said. I haven't seen Darius Baker since he moved home. He's only been here a week. The moving trucks have barely unloaded his furniture at the Devlin home place, and it's not like Darius and I were ever close friends or anything. He's 4 years older than us. By the time you and I were at Stella Maris High, he was already on his way to Hollywood. I hadn't planned on taking him a casserole. Have you?
Me?
Moon raised her eyebrows.
Why, no, I haven't seen him. I hadn't even thought about a casserole. Do you think we should take him a casserole?
No, I do not.
I searched my brain for anything I knew about Darius Baker.
He did date Trina Lynn in high school, but good grief, that was more than 20 years ago.
Did you ever hear anything about him maybe being rough with her? Asked Moon.
Colleen stared at Moon.
They think Darius killed Trina Lynn.
Wait, I said. What? I always thought he was like the court jester of his class. He wrapped the principal's car in a ton of cellophane so he couldn't drive to school the last day of final exams.
I don't think they actually proved that was him, said Moon.
He and a couple of his buddies rearranged everyone's Christmas yard decorations so that the reindeer were being frisky with each other. Mama had a fit over that one.
That was back before everyone had cameras in their doorbells, so no one was actually apprehended, said Moon.
But everyone in town knew Darius was behind it, I said.
Well, that was the rumor, said Moon.
He was a clown, I said.
Moon shrugged, made a face that said she conceded the point.
A very handsome clown.
He was a football player, I said.
I seem to remember he had a reputation for being a bit of a tough guy, never backed down from a fight, but I never heard he hit Trina Lynn.
It was probably just talk, said Moon.
Everyone said she broke Darius's heart and that's why he left like he did, with barely a word to anyone.
She kicked him to the curb, said Colleen. I remember that much.
But again, Moon, I said, that was more than 20 years ago. They both moved a long time ago.
It's interesting they both ended up on television, isn't it? Asked Moon.
I suppose, I said. But there's no connection at all. Trina Lynn was an investigative reporter at WCSC. She was a local celebrity, sure, but Darius? Darius is a household name. I doubt they've seen each other since the day he left town.
I wonder if that's true, mused Moon.
She gave me this encouraging look, like maybe she was steering me down the right track.
Sunny thinks after all this time Darius was jealous of some boyfriend of Trina's or something?
I was highly skeptical of this notion.
I'm sure I wouldn't know, said Moon.
And a week after he moves home, he tracks her to Philadelphia Alley and shoots her.
There's that Cecil look again, said Colleen. Kind of like a turtle. I always thought Cecil looked like a turtle after he shaved his head.
While Moon stared into space, I cut Colleen a warning look.
You know, said Moon, I don't think he has been home a single solitary time since he left. His poor mama left not long after he did. I'm kind of surprised, to tell you the truth, that he came back here.
There's no place like home, I shrugged. It's remote enough. I guess I can see the appeal for a semi-retired celebrity. Plus, he was always close to his Aunt Nell. She and Bill practically raised Darius. Nell Cooper, née Baker, Blake's dispatcher and administrative assistant, was Darius's aunt. Her younger brother, Marcus, had a wild streak a mile wide and an out-of-wedlock baby with Jasmine King. By all accounts, Jasmine tried to be a good mother, but she was only 17 when Darius was born, and Marcus didn't stick around.
Humph, they sure were good to him, said Moon. If you ask me, he could have made life a lot easier for them. He must be right up there with Oprah in the earnings department.
I wouldn't go that far. Why do Sonny and his partner suspect Darius? I asked.
That's not entirely accurate.
Moon wore a pained look. I tilted my head, looked at her sideways.
Am I going to have to guess every single bit of this story you're not telling me?
Uh-huh. She nodded, a pleased look on her face, as if she was proud of a slow student.
Hells, bells, Moon! Can't you just tell me, in strictest confidence, of course, what it is you think Sonny wants me to know? I won't breathe a single word of it. Although, if he wants me to know anyway, never mind. Just tell me for Pete's sake.
I can't do that. Moon reached across the table and grabbed my hands. Her large eyes pleaded with me to understand. She vibrated with tension. How much had the strain of not talking raised her blood pressure?
I'm so sorry.
All right, fine. I stabbed my fork at my Cobb salad. So, Jeremy Jenkins suspects Darius, but Sonny's not on board, or is someone pressuring both of them? Moon beamed, nodded quickly. Was Darius in Charleston Sunday night around the time Trina was killed? I asked.
That's my understanding, said Moon.
Was he with anyone? I asked.
Exactly.
Moon made a rolling motion with her hands, the way people do when you're on the right track in charades.
Someone?
He was with Trina Lynn, I asked. Moon clapped twice and pointed at me.
Where? Where was he with Trina? What time?
Well, maybe you should ask Darius about all of that. Moon had a hopeful look on her face. Moon, the man is a celebrity. He probably has bodyguards. I can't just waltz over there and interrogate him regarding the murder of his high school girlfriend. When Darius left for Hollywood, he probably had dreams of being the next Eddie Murphy. He'd had a decent run as a stand-up comic, but his big break didn't come until he landed the role on Main Street USA, a reality TV show where he visited a different small town each week, eating at local restaurants, visiting festivals, and interviewing old men swapping lies at the hardware store. He'd filmed 10 seasons before retiring. He was also the brand ambassador for Best Dang Drawers, a high-dollar line of men's underwear.
Sure you can, Moon nodded emphatically. And you'd better hurry.
Colleen stared at Moon Unit.
What's going on in there? Can you read her mind?
Sonny and Jeremy Jenkins are on the 1:30 ferry from Isle of Palms, said Colleen. They have an appointment with Blake at 2:15.
The only reason I could think of that both Sonny and Jeremy Jenkins would have an official appointment with Blake was they were coming to make an arrest. There's no other reason they'd involve Blake in their case. Darius had been gone too long for Blake to have background information they needed. I stood, grabbed my tote. I need my check, Moon.
It's on the house, she said. Go! Don't forget my ham biscuits, said Colleen.
Don't forget your ham biscuits. Moon jumped up, ran behind the counter, and grabbed a takeout bag from under the hot lights on the pass-through bar to the kitchen.
Here you go.
Thanks. I took the bag from her and headed for the door.
Liz?
I stopped, pivoted back toward her. Moon's face was washed in uncertainty.
Just in case I misunderstood, please don't mention anything I said unless you absolutely have to, okay? I don't want to mess this thing up. Me and Sunny, I mean.
I grinned, shook my head. Moon, I honestly can't recall you telling me a solitary thing.
2.
From the outside, the home Stuart and Kate Devlin had built and raised two sons in looked the same as it always had. Two stories of white-painted wood sat atop twin garages with a central staircase sweeping up from the brick walkway to the wraparound porch. On each front corner, the porch jutted out into twin square porch rooms that might have been turrets were they round and on a Victorian home. The house and all its porches were topped with an array of shiny silver roofs. The woodwork was stained dark, the architectural details nautical. I had rarely been back inside the house since the night Kate Devlin died in front of me. At the bottom of the steps, I steeled myself, squared my shoulders, and climbed to the porch.
He's here alone.
Colleen was behind me, her voice right in my ear.
Gah! Are you trying to give me an early heart attack?
As if, said Colleen. I'd have to train a new POC. That'd be a pain. I figure your heart's pretty healthy as much as you run.
I was Colleen's only point of contact right up until Nate and I got married. Now we shared that mixed blessing. I shook my head, rolled my eyes.
Go finish your ham biscuits.
She'd been in the back seat, out of sight, munching away when I got out of the car.
Okay.
She said in a sing-song voice that notified me how I was going to regret that suggestion. The door swung open.
Can I help you?
Darius Baker looked around, his face screwed up in a confused look. Dressed in a designer warm-up suit, he was tall, fit, and completely bald, his smooth skin the color of Belgian milk chocolate.
Thought I heard you talking to somebody out here. You by yourself?
Colleen laughed and faded away. I am. Mr. Baker?
That's me.
I held out a hand. I'm Liz Talbot. You probably don't remember me.
Blake Talbot's little sister?
I smiled. That's right. He nodded, grinned. His teeth were brilliant white, perfect celebrity teeth.
You the one my cousin Clay was always sweet on.
I half laughed, shook my head. It was common knowledge Clay'd had a crush on me in high school, but he'd never asked me out.
Did he?
Girl, if you didn't know that, you was the only one. I heard you was smart, so I'm thinking you know that's the truth. What can I help you with?
The way he spoke was some hybrid blend of down-home southern black, laced with an occasional touch of Hollywood. It was relatable. It was his brand, the down-to-earth way he spoke on television to people across the country. I had no doubt that he could dial it up or down at will, just like I could my own southern drawl.
I'm hoping I can help you, I said.
Is that right? Well, don't stand here on the porch. Come on in and tell me all about it.
He opened the door wide, stepped back, and gestured elaborately with his left arm.
You've redecorated, I said.
The house was nearly unrecognizable inside, and I was grateful for that.
The interior designer did all of that. Updated it. Just a nip here and a tuck there. Can I get you something to drink? I got a pitcher of iced tea in the kitchen. Fresh made.
Sure, that sounds great.
Right this way.
I followed him down the hall to the back of the house. It looked like Chip and Joanna Gaines had been hired and given an unlimited budget. The kitchen and dining room were now all one room with two dining areas, as well as a U-shaped row of high back counter stools. Everything was white on white except for the black marble countertops, dark wood floors, and stainless steel appliances.
Your decorator did an excellent job.
Whoever it was had worked fast. There'd been a swarm of workers on the property for the past 2 weeks, but I was nevertheless amazed at how much the place had changed.
Thank you.
He handed me a glass of tea.
Grab a stool.
He settled into one on the corner and motioned me toward one across from him.
Welcome home, I smiled.
Thanks, he said. There's no place like home. Every small town I've been to made me homesick for this place. It's special.
It is that, I said.
My spirit's at rest here, you know what I mean?
I do. I feel exactly the same way.
Now, tell me, he said, what kind of help do I need?
Mr. Baker.
Enough of that. Call me Darius. You're making me feel old up in here.
I nodded. Darius, first, I should tell you, I'm a private investigator.
Oh, damn. This don't sound like good news.
Honestly, it's not. You're aware that Trina Lynn Causby was killed Sunday night in Charleston? He looked down at his glass of iced tea, drew a deep breath.
Yeah, I know about that.
When's the last time you saw her? I asked. He raised his head. His eyes wary.
I had dinner with her Sunday night in Charleston. We went to Hall's Chop House. Why do you ask?
Is there any reason you can think of that the police might suspect you are responsible for her death?
Me?
I nodded.
I just got back into town, remember? I knew Trina in high school. We dated. First girl I ever loved. You might remember about that. Course, living in Mount Pleasant, she went to Wando, so maybe not. But back then, all of East Cooper was a lot smaller place. But Sunday night is the first time I seen that girl in more than 20 years. We hadn't had time to get that mad at each other yet.
I understand, and I know this sounds crazy.
You're right about that now. This conversation is a waste of damn time. I know I might have had a certain reputation when I was in high school, but hell, none of us are what we were in high school now, are we?
Of course not.
You might have heard I made something of myself.
I know, of course. It's just,
and on top of that, I got myself 3 ex-wives, every one of them healthy as they can be. If I was ever going to shoot a woman, it would have been number 2. Mean girl, but not a one of them ever been shot. Let me tell you something. They live well. I take good care of the women who hate my guts. Not that Trina did. It wasn't like that. Nah,
He shook his head vigorously. So you and Trina didn't have a disagreement Sunday night? His eyes got big and round, his expression resembling that of a possum staring down a freight train.
Well, now, I didn't say that exactly.
What did you argue about exactly?
We might have remembered certain things a little differently. I might have said some stupid things.
I raised my eyebrows, inquiring.
Something along the lines of, like, maybe she threw me out like the damn trash because I had dreams she was too immature to understand at the time. I might have been all, how do you like me now? Like, maybe I was showing her something. Maybe she didn't take all of that too well.
Go figure. How did she react? He shrugged, looked innocent.
Trina? She was a lady. I could have said all that to some other woman, and they might have been broke shit all over that restaurant. But Trina kept her cool. I mean, she let me know how I was an idiot and all of that, but she didn't get loud or nothing.
Did anyone overhear the argument?
Well, they could have.
He rubbed a spot above his right ear, like maybe he was smoothing his non-existent hair.
"What time did you leave the restaurant?" I asked. "It was about 10 minutes till 10. Things had calmed down. We had a nice dinner, but she said she had to meet someone, a source for a story she'd been working on."
"Do you know where?"
"Nah, she didn't say."
"Do you know who?"
Nah.
"Do you have any idea what story it was related to?"
He shook his head. "She was all tight-lipped about it."
"Have you spoken to the police?"
"Yeah, a couple detectives came by yesterday. Sonny Ravenel, you know him?"
I nodded. "Sure."
"Him and his partner asked me about all of this, but they weren't thinking like I had anything to do with hurting Trina."
"Did they say that?"
"Not in so many words, but what kind of sense would that make?"
He was getting louder, agitated.
"We didn't even barely know each other anymore. People don't go killing strangers. Well, I guess some folks do, but I'm not a damn psychopath."
"Of course you're not." I used my calming voice.
"I'm Mr. Main Street USA."
"Congratulations on all of your success." I offered him my sunniest smile. He seemed slightly mollified.
"You said you could help me. Tell me exactly how that is."
I sighed. "I have reason to believe you are a person of interest in the Charleston Police Department's investigation. In fact, I think they may consider you their primary suspect."
"Say what?"
"And if I'm right..."
"That's just crazy right there."
"Okay, but listen to me, please." He eyed me for a minute.
"I'm listening."
"Do you have a local attorney?"
"Yeah, That was the first thing I did when I got home after 21 years was hire myself a lawyer just in case somebody I knew got killed and I happened to look guilty. Who does that?"
"I'll take that as a no."
"I got contract lawyers and divorce lawyers, but they all in California. The only local lawyer I got is the one from when I bought this house."
"You need a criminal attorney, a good one, a local one. Charleston judges aren't all that fond of attorneys from off." I pulled one of Fraser Rutledge's cards from my purse and laid it on the counter in front of him. "He's one of the best. If it comes to it, call him."
"I don't need no damn hoity-toity Broad Street lawyer."
Darius slid the card back toward me on the counter.
"No, thank you. This here is crazy, like I told you."
I didn't pick it up. "My partner and I often work with Rutledge and Radcliffe, Fraser's firm. The Charleston police won't make an arrest until they can make a case. At that point, you'll need investigators to run down alternative theories of the crime for your defense attorney to present to the jury."
"Jury?"
He drew back, an incredulous look on his face. Then he nodded.
Okay, I see what this is about."
"What do you mean?"
"Local boy makes good on TV, has endorsement contracts, comes home, buys himself a big-ass house right on the beach, remodels, puts in a pool. He's obviously rolling in some serious dough. You want to be on my payroll."
"I assure you, I have plenty to keep me busy. I don't need your money." This wasn't strictly true. Nate and I needed a steady stream of paying clients to keep up the beautiful but aging beach house my Gram left me. But we stayed busy enough. "I'm here as a favor to a friend."
"And just who might that be?"
The doorbell rang. We both looked down the hall. He raised his eyebrows, shrugged.
"I'm not expecting company this afternoon,"
he said.
"Of course, I wasn't expecting you either. Whatever they're selling, I don't need. Where were we?"
"I was explaining how you need to call Fraser Rutledge Lickety Split," I said.
"And just like I was telling you..."
The doorbell rang again, 3 times in rapid succession.
"Now that's just plain rude."
He glared toward the door.
"And I wouldn't have expected that here, you know what I mean? Folks here was always the kind that call before they just show up on your front porch, hammering on your doorbell. What is this world coming to? If folks here done lost their manners, I don't even know what to think. That's disappointing. Mm-mm-mm. He pressed his lips together, shook his head. A fist banged on the door.
Darius Baker, Charleston police, open the door.
Oh, shit. Darius's voice went high-pitched. His face reflected astonishment. I slid the card back to him. Listen to me, I said. Go quietly. Do not say one single word except lawyer. Do you understand me?
Oh, yeah. I understand you just fine. I'm being railroaded on this here thing so someone can look good closing a high-profile case fast.
I don't think that's it, truly. More banging on the front door.
Darius Baker, we know you're in there.
Sonny's voice. He knew I was in here, too. He knew the white Ford Escape parked out front was mine. Blake would be with him. This was Stella Maris and out of Sonny's jurisdiction. Answer the door, I said. I'll call Fraser Rutledge and have him meet you at the jail.
This here is privileged communication, right?
Provided Fraser Rutledge is your attorney, my firm is on retainer with his.
Well, see, I might have left out a little part of that story I was telling you just now.
Fill me in, quick.
Remember how I said I had 3 ex-wives?
All healthy, yes.
The truth is, I might have understated that number by 1.
And?
100 years ago, Trina Lynn was actually my first wife, if that was even legal. It shouldn't have been. We were way too young.
That's a pretty big omission. Did you leave anything else out? He reached up, rubbed his smooth head with both hands.
Oh, Lord.
I can't help you unless you tell me absolutely everything. He said something. His voice soft, wounded.
More banging on the door.
What did you say?
I said we had a child.
His voice was coated in misery. When?
I was already gone. Trina, she put the child, a little boy, up for adoption.
How is that not common knowledge in this town?
I got no damn idea. I didn't know myself until recently.
The doorbell rang 3 times in succession.
Darius DeAndre Baker, this is your Aunt Nell. You get yourself out here right this very minute.
Of course. Nell knew everything that happened at the Stella Maris Police Department. She ran the place, regardless of who was chief. No way would she have stayed behind while Sonny and Blake came to arrest Darius.
Ah, nah.
Darius strode towards the door and I followed. He flung it open.
Aunt Nell.
Nell Avalee Baker Cooper, a full-figured black woman, wore a tailored pink suit, heels, and pearls. Her salon blowout drooped a bit from the humidity. She planted her hands on her hips and bowed up, ready to strike. She clutched a dangerously large coach carry-all that matched her suit in her right hand.
Stand back, Sonny Ravenel. You can have him when I'm finished with him. He's not going anywhere.
Sonny took a step back.
Yes, ma'am.
His eyes met mine. I knew Sonny well enough to know he was relieved to see me. Moon had been right. Blake stood off to one side. Jeremy Jenkins must have gone around back. I stole a glance at Blake. He nodded ever so slightly, looked away. The fact that he said nothing told me all I needed to know. He was happy to see me, too.
What is this I hear, Darius?
Nell asked.
You've barely been home 5 minutes, and you're in trouble with the law already.
Now, Aunt Nell, don't you now Aunt Nell me. I want the truth out of you, right now. Did you hurt Trina Lynn?
Of course not. Aunt Nell, you know me better than that.
You know I ain't hurt nobody, especially not a woman, most especially not Trina Lynn.
She stared him down, took his measure.
No, I don't think you did. So you go along with Sonny now.
She swiveled her head toward Sonny.
He won't let a soul harm a solitary hair.
She spun back to Darius, took in his smooth head.
Sonny's not going to allow anybody to hurt you. Isn't that right, Sonny?
No, ma'am,
said Sonny.
I beg your pardon?
Nell's tone threatened to call down a plague.
I mean, yes, ma'am, said Sonny. Nell, all due respect, you know better than to think I'd let anything bad happen to Darius.
She jerked her head back to Darius. It crossed my mind how she was in serious danger of giving herself whiplash.
You keep your mouth shut tight. You hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
I will see about getting you a good lawyer, said Nell.
I've already got me a lawyer.
This is no job for one of your slick Hollywood mouthpieces. I got me a local attorney, a good one. Now, Aunt Nell, don't you go worrying yourself. This here is all a big misunderstanding. We're gonna get it straightened right out. I even got my own investigator.
He looked over his shoulder at me. Nell raised an eyebrow at me.
Mm-hmm, I see that.
Jeremy Jenkins climbed the last step to the porch. Why am I not surprised? Tall, with broad shoulders, if he hadn't had such a nasty look on his face, he would have been handsome. Sonny, I said, Detective Jenkins, Mr. Baker is represented by Rutledge and Radcliffe. Mr. Rutledge will meet y'all at the jail. Jeremy muttered something under his breath.
All right, then, said Sonny. Let's head in that direction, why don't we? Darius Baker, you are under arrest for the murder of Trina Lynn Causby. You have the right to remain silent, and you see that you do that very thing, said Nell. I will, Aunt Nell. Everything's going to be all right.
Nell looked heavenward and raised her hands.
Lord Jesus, look after Darius. Keep him safe from harm. Help us find the truth about what happened to poor Trina Lynn, Lord. We know the truth will set Darius free. Amen.
Nell looked at me hard.
I'll expect to hear from you directly.
Yes, ma'am, I said.
Of course.
3. I loved my new escape, but missed the happy green color of the one we'd recently traded. White showed every speck of dirt and dust. But white and silver were the most common car colors in the country. Private investigators needed to blend in. As soon as I was in the car and the air conditioning cooled things down, I called Fraser Rutledge and outlined Darius's situation.
Very well, Ms. Talbot.
Fraser never let an opportunity escape to express his disapproval of the fact I hadn't taken Nate's last name.
I will meet with Mr. Baker and then ascertain how quickly we can get before a circuit court judge on the matter of a bond. I gather that you and Mr. Andrews will begin investigative work forthwith.
Our contract with Rutledge and Radcliffe for a recent case was open-ended, allowing us to begin work on behalf of any of Fraser's clients without executing a new agreement. While Darius hadn't technically hired us, signed our contract for services, Fraser had. Any client of Rutledge and Radcliffe's was a client of ours as soon as we did work on the client's behalf at Fraser's request, or that of his partner, Eli Radcliffe. Nate is still finalizing the pre-trial work for Lucas v. Lucas, I said. I can get started right away on Mr. Baker's case. Nate and I had planned to take some time off as soon as he finished the Lucas case and enjoy the beach, catch up on our reading. That would now have to wait.
I was given to understand the two of you had wrapped up Lucas, Ms. Talbot.
Mr. Rutledge, you might recall our conversation on Thursday. We were sitting right in front of your desk when we mentioned there was a loose end or two and that Nate was going to follow up on those.
Precisely. That was Thursday. Today is Tuesday, and the sun which the good Lord hung in the sky has set and risen again 5 times in the interim. I dislike loose ends, Miss Talbot. The Lucases go to court next week.
Which is why Nate is still focused on the Lucas case, and I will get started on the Baker-Causby matter.
No one speaks to the media except me.
The media. Sweet baby Moses in a basket. Stella Maris was about to be invaded. Of course. Will you be stashing Mr. Baker in a hotel under an assumed name?
Not at this time. Let us have a multitude of unruly reporters trampling through his yard and taping spots in front of Mr. Baker's home for the time being. We cannot have him appear to go into hiding. Optics, Ms. Talbot. We start thinking about our jury pool and what they see and hear right now. Perhaps the logistics involved in travel to Stella Maris may prove a deterrent to the Fourth Estate after the first week.
I'll alert the local authorities. Blake would no doubt rather Darius stayed in a yurt on the moon than Stella Maris under the circumstances.
Very well. I will see you and Mr. Andrews tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock in my office.
He ended the call. High-handed bore. Frazier Alston Rutledge III, Esquire, challenged my sunny disposition. While we'd steadfastly refused to become the in-house investigators for Rutledge and Ratcliffe, preferring to retain our autonomy, Frazier had managed to arrange things to suit himself through trickery.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.